Hello and welcome to Woman Up, the podcast series by Desperate Artwives. Woman Up is a podcast talking to women artists, creatives, art critics, feminist historians, activists and more. The series was conceived by Desperate Artwives founder Amy Dignam in collaboration with me, Susan Merrick. Desperate Artwives is a platform established in 2010 for women artists who are also mothers and carers. Amy's work focuses on domestic disorder, unsteady identity, power and dysfunction. And I'm an artist interested in feminism, language, power and access. In this platform, we share conversations with women that inspire us and our work, whilst producing a long-form content of resources for other people to access. Hello and welcome to Woman Up, the podcast series by Desperate Artwives. I'm Susan Merrick and today I'm here with an artist and performer, Shirley Cameron. Shirley Cameron has been making work across six decades, so I'm really excited to hear about her practice. Hi, Shirley.
Hello. Good. I'm pleased to be here.
I'm very pleased that you could be with us today. Thank you. I would like to start, Shirley. So I've looking over your website, looking over the past works that I've seen online. You've been working, as I say, across six decades. You've covered sculpture, set making, performance, speaking, collaboration. More recently, you've worked with tree installations and yoga and religious philosophy. Over all that time, what was your favourite decade, or what was your favourite period of work, just to get us started, and why?
Well, that's a very hard question, of course. I mean, the decade where I did most work was the 70s, really. And so, from an art point of view, I guess that was, yeah, I just did a huge lot. And I suppose I did have quite a few opportunities. People were inviting us to lots of festivals in different places, mainly in Europe and Britain. And in the middle of that decade, I had my twin daughters and was able to involve them in the work. And yeah, I guess it was mostly a happy decade.
So you worked with your partner, Roland Miller, for much of your performance work. How was it to have not only a partner who was an artist, but as a collaborator?
that's a big question. Of course, it was great and an absolute nightmare as well. I mean, really, it just was the whole thing. Yeah, really. I mean, yeah, everybody has got their qualities, and I think he was good at being a front man and getting the work. I mean, in a way, I did need that when I left art school, and you know, I didn't have any natural resources in terms of people supporting me, like parents or anything like that. and so I did need some support, and so it, you know, but it's that kind of deal that you make has its good side and its not so good side, because really, if you want to do something, in a way you should do it yourself, but you know, we're only human. There's limited possibilities.
I totally agree with that, and collaboration all the way for me. It's much easier to share the workload, I think, than do it all on your own.
Yeah. So, I mean, I have worked with quite a lot of other people, but, yeah, initially I did work with him a lot, yeah.
You had quite a lot of art school experience, which then led to you going to Central St Martin's, where you studied sculpture. Then for the majority of your practice, you were using that sculptural background, but you were also, you had moved more into performance. How did that shift from sculpture to performance happen?
I guess it was quite a lot to do with meeting Roland, but also to do with, you know, just how can you survive as an artist if you're good at making very large geometric sculptures out of metal and wood and fiberglass and so on, you know. How is the world going to invite you to do that all over the place and fund it? Just quite hard. And also, I was working at Stock World Depot. Most of my fellow students in those days at St. Martin's were men, I believe. You know, now if you go into a sculpture department, it'd probably be mostly women. But in those days, it was mostly men. And at Stock World Depot, I was the only woman sculptor there initially. And the first exhibition they put on, I mean, they actually didn't invite me to be in it. So oh, wow. It was, pretty devastating, really, that experience. I mean, you could say they didn't do it deliberately. They were all going off to the pub together and, you know, kind of, oh, yeah, there's Shirley in that room there. We didn't kind of quite notice her. Or who knows? I haven't had that conversation. I was young. I just left art school. I didn't expect it to happen, because when I was at art school, I was, you know, my work was well appreciated, so I thought I had a certain status, but turned out I didn't.
Just before we started recording, Shirley, I was asking you about an article you'd written, or I suppose a short essay you'd written, just about your beginnings of practice. And you mentioned that at the end of the time at Central St. Martin's, you had recently married, and then there was something where ex-students or recent graduates were listed, and then their professions were listed. And what had you been put down as, because you were recently married, not because you weren't practicing, I hasten to say.
Absolutely. I was put down as a housewife. Mm-hmm. Yes. It was a booklet, because when art schools changed to DPD from what they'd been before, NDD, way back, St. Martin's Sculpture Department in the first year was not accepted. It failed, in other words. And so they made a big effort of producing this booklet with photos of sculptures. It had a photograph of my sculpture in it, but, yeah, I hadn't, you know, some of the ex-students had gone straight into teaching jobs. I hadn't, and so they put me down as housewife.
Yeah, well, which was, you know.
I was absolutely humiliated by it, yeah.
I mean, nothing to discredit those who are housewives and are happy to be called housewives.
Yes.
However, when you have a practicing profession and that's who you just qualified as, that's what you want to,
exactly.
You would like that on there.
No way, I saw myself as being a housewife.
Yeah.
I was not. And, I had a job. In fact, I couldn't just survive on making sculpture, far from it. It's an expensive thing to do. So not only was I not a housewife, I was also working in a youth club.
I love seeing all the images of your performances, your own and those with Roland Miller, across the decades. And what struck myself and Amy when we were looking at your work was how often we see your children, your twins, in the imagery, either as part of the performance or, I suppose, as part of the audience. Was that something that was decided on? Did you know any other artists who were doing the same? Was it for logistical reasons, artistic reasons? I'd love to know more about it.
No, I think generally, as a person, I'm a kind of inclusive person, and it just didn't occur to me not to have them in. I wanted to have them in. I mean, I did have some opposition from collaborators that I was working with, but I did always want to have them in the work and to have them as far as possible contributing to the work, you know, not just being. But it also had a practical side because, you know, if I was going off, for instance, to the Academy Gallery in Liverpool, I did an early piece with the twins in it as babies. I mean, it was in a gallery, so the piece lasted, you know, a lot of the day. I just didn't have anybody that would be looking after them, really. But they kind of had to be in it, yeah. And, I have got a funny story about that. I don't know how funny it is. It's a bit of a... We also went round giving lectures in art colleges and taking girls. So we were at this art college, and I think I quite often would make a little circle of cloth or something like that, you know, because it's just a lecture, you know, we put the girls in it. And they were babies just there. But on this particular occasion, I was doing a little performance, I think they involved spinning, and one of the girls crawled out of the circle, and I kind of knocked into her. She wasn't armed, honestly, but afterwards I went to the opening of the Icon Gallery in Birmingham when it very first opened, the first Icon, and it was like Arts Council people giving speeches. We were there with the girls, and I was introduced to one of these Arts Council people, and I think he said, "Oh, you're the woman that treads on the babies." He's like, "No, I do not." So my reputation had gone before me. So it was a funny story, but not that funny. you have to tell these stories. I mean, it's the gossip. The gossiping in the art world. Not nice.
You showed us an image before of a piece of work called Rabbits.
Yeah.
And the image is of you covered in almost a black mesh netting, and you're pregnant, and you have monitoring strips on you as well. Is that right? And rabbits around. Could you describe that piece of work for
yes.
me?
Yes, it is a piece of work quite fond of, really, because I think it worked well. I made a kind of wire mesh nominal sort of house and garden. So it was a bit like a cage, but anyway, I was dressed as a pregnant bunny girl, and because we were in an agricultural show, that's what happens, you're showing animals in cages. And so it could work on different levels. Obviously, a pregnant bunny girl is something quite amusing in a way, something you wouldn't have. But I could also be a bit like Mrs. Rabbit, reading Peter Rabbit stories to the rabbits, trying to encourage them to be, well, like babies, really, put on their clothes, eat. I had a little table laid out with knives and forks. Try to, be well-behaved rabbits like Peter Rabbit. And so that could be kind of a bit of a sweet side, or I could be more like the woman in the cage, which could be a bit more sinister. I also had a stove, so I would cook up some food, and I would say, "Oh, I'm going to, I might put the rabbits in the stew today. I might make rabbit stew." I never did, of course. I couldn't. I don't know. Couldn't kill a rabbit. I mean, really. And, that's right. I can remember another thing. We had a rabbit jelly mould. You know the rabbit jelly moulds? I'd make jelly and put it down for the rabbits to eat. So that was a bit of a kind of moment. Ooh, they were eating the jelly mould of a rabbit. And things like that. So
wonderful.
We toured agricultural shows. So.
I think that, that context of putting them in the agricultural shows as well is really, that's really fantastic.
Yeah. And they're good places. We did other pieces of work in agricultural shows because they're very popular, you know, hundreds of people come along.
How was that received? So coming from, I come from East Yorkshire and it's a real farming land. And I honestly cannot say I've ever seen anything like that at any of the agricultural shows my mum and dad used to take me to growing up. How was it received in the in that?
Very well, because I think that we found in those days that a non-art audience would usually just love what we were doing. It's only when you got into, only when you got into a gallery sometimes you'd I mean we were once on a touring exhibition at the gallery in Liverpool, the Walker Art Gallery in Liverpool, and I swear that the curators, when they had to walk through the gallery that we were in, were turning their heads to the wall so they shouldn't have to see us, and so they shouldn't have to be asked, what do you think of that work? Because in those days, you know, I swear that's what happened. They just didn't want, they didn't have an opinion, and they didn't want to have an opinion, you know, because they just didn't know if it was art, if it was good, or if it was bad. They didn't want to talk about it, but they didn't want to look at it, you know, which it, I think is quite bad, you know, because curiosity is a basic human quality, isn't it, really? You know.
So actually being in, as you say, the non-art audience,
you
have then an audience who are willing to say, what is this, what are you doing and why, and have that conversation.
Yeah, really, they are, yeah.
Yeah.
And, you know, not kind of embarrassed about it, or, you know, no preconceptions, not expecting it to be this, that or the other. And,
That's so interesting.
Quite well. You know, this is the old days of the 70s. Probably really more people, obviously more people have seen performance art now, that kind of thing. So.
Yeah, which I think has its positives and negatives, because I think people have their own preconceptions now.
Of course they do. Yeah. Yeah, more people will be in that category that will say, you know, before they look, oh, yeah, I don't like that sort of work, or, oh, I always like that one, you know, kind of. It's really, it's meant to be visual, isn't it, art?
So coming on to another piece of work where you involved the children directly, it's a piece of work called Washing the Twins. Could you describe that piece of work for myself and for the listeners, please?
Yeah, well, it was an arts festival in Portugal that we were invited to. And I think we'd been to one the year before, but this one, our friend Angela Carter said that she'd like to come with us. And we said, oh, that would be lovely, really nice.
Angela Carter, as in the author?
Yes. Yeah. She wanted to write some articles for New Society, which she did, and about Portugal, but also about this festival. And it was in a smallish town called Caldas de Rainha. And we came along with a performance that we prepared beforehand and did that. But that's what's really great about being able to work in a festival where you can then get inspiration from the environment you're in. So in this park that we were working quite a lot, there was a rather lumpy sculpture over life size of twins, or, you know, what looked like twins. And I just had the idea for this performance called Washing the Twins. It was just a spontaneous idea that I had a tub of water, so I was washing my actual twins, and Angela was washing the sculpture of the twins. And then I put clean clothes on my girls, and she was trying to put clothes on the sculpture. And basically that was the performance. So yeah, we had a little audience and that's what we did, and yeah, had a few bits of people clapping and laughing and so on. And but I don't think the museum people were very pleased, actually, because obviously it's not very respectful to sculptures to kind of try to put clothes on naked sculptures.
I think it's brilliant. I noticed that when you worked, did your work with Roland, your partner Roland, and sometimes your daughters as well, you often had coloured limbs. So maybe your hands and arms were coloured one colour, and then your feet and lower legs were coloured another. What was the reasoning behind that?
Oh, well, that was an initial performance that we got together for a tour in Poland. And the idea was that our legs and feet were blue, so any movement we made, footsteps, they would be blue. Obviously we'd stand in some paint to make them blue. So everything coming from our legs was blue. Everything coming from our head was yellow, so our words would be yellow, and you know, our, if it was smoking, it would be yellow, and so on. And from our hands, everything we did with our hands would be red. So that was the idea behind it. And then we definitely had some props around that. I had some gloves with very, very long, with sticks sticking out, very long fingers and so on. And so it was just, once you had that idea, you could improvise around that. So that's what it was. But then, of course, we did have those costumes, as it were, and we probably used them for one or two other things. Or one other thing I can think of that wasn't so much in the original idea. So just how it goes, really. But the performance of me in the tree in Germany did continue that idea, because I was wearing a yellow wig, so my hair was yellow, and there was yellow wool going out to the branches, so it was that continuation of the yellow. And with my red hands, I was knitting with red wool, so it, you know, did have that kind of thing. So that was the idea behind it. Yeah,
amazing. There's some absolutely incredible work that you've done, Shirley. You talked to us earlier about, I suppose, a quietening down of work or a longer period of hiatus between works, because I know you did some more work again in your home in the 2000s, but you had some time where you didn't work as much. Could you tell us a bit more about that, about the...
Well, I was working very full-time for 20 years, or just over 20 years, and then... In 89, really, it was, I just was doing so many different pieces of work, and it was a very hot summer. I had an installation in the gallery in Sheffield, and I'm a Red Ladder Theatre Group. It was an anniversary, and I was given the job to curate a couple of exhibitions for them and organise a party of ex-workers for Red Ladder. Obviously, I had made stage sets for Red Ladder Theatre Group, so that's how I ended up being given this piece of work. But, you know, it was very, pretty intense. So I was also at Glastonbury Festival working with F. Silver and in some other festivals in Sheffield, and it was just so much work that I was doing mainly in that summer, that by the end of the summer, by September, when I was planning to have a little holiday, I just really had a kind of mental and physical collapse. I was just sort of exhausted, really. And it turned out to be rheumatoid arthritis that I had, which is an immune disease. So, by and by, I did recover from that. But I couldn't walk for a while. I think your body is telling you something when you can't walk. It's saying, stop, stop. So I did get the message. I thought, oh, I must get myself a different job. I can't be full-time working as an artist because it's just too much work, really. I did get a job running a community centre on my own, actually. People said, oh, isn't that hard work? Running a community centre, doing all the grant applications, doing getting the volunteers, monitoring them and training them and kind of doing all, and organising festivals. We had some, it was Caribbean as well as the Somali area. We had some Caribbean carnivals that I organised and so on. And people did say to me, oh, it looks like that's very hard work, that job you're doing. It's like, no, not as hard work as being an artist.
Oh, wow.
Because I was, on a salary, which is a nice luxury, isn't it?
So you mentioned briefly there you work with Eve Silver, and you also work with Monica Ross, is that right, as well? What works did you do with those artists?
Well, in the early 80s, there was a lot of fear of a nuclear attack. I was genuine worry that something was about to happen. And so we got together, Monica Ross, Ed Silver, myself, and two other artists who are poets, Gillian Allnut and Mary Michaels, and got together and organised kind of anti-nuclear exhibition. But we wanted our exhibition to not be like a kind of lots of weapons crossed out, it's just sort of a negative thing, isn't it? It's like, we don't want this. So at the time, there was quite a lot of work. So we wanted something that would be positive about peace, really. So we got this exhibition together, and it was a series of panels. And it was booked out, there were so many anti-nuclear festivals and gatherings at that time. It was booked out for over 60 times, and we were charging for it. So, I mean, in terms of a travelling exhibition, it was incredibly successful, really. And we did have performances that went with it, so we weren't always booked for the performances as well, but quite a lot. So so we had, the poets had some poems, and Ev, Monica and I had performances we did. So it was good. And it was, Ev had been on the original march to Greenham Common, and the women at Greenham Common kind of hosted this exhibition, the initial exhibition. So it was good. We got a lot of support. And, that's how we started working. That's how I started working with Monica. And then we went on to do a few other things. We did a residency in Rochdale Art Gallery.
Nice.
For instance.
Yeah. We talked earlier a bit about you working with your children and then being part of some of the pieces, art pieces. It's something that Amy and I have talked about and lots of the other artists that are connected with Desperate Artwives talk about, because it comes up in terms of talking about ethics of who owns what and that, those kinds of topics.
Yes, of course.
I'm interested to know, how do your grown-up children feel about their involvement in your art practice when they were younger now?
Now, well, I think, they're 45 now. I think they're kind of proud of us, what we've done. But it probably did make them feel insecure, really, because we were travelling around and, they were given jobs. For instance, we travelled mostly by train, so we'd have lots and lots of bits of luggage, and it was one of their jobs to help count the luggage as it came out of the train and things like that. So they did have some responsibilities, and which I thought was a good idea. I mean, but I think people are more aware of boundaries now, because being brought up in the 40s and 50s, it was quite a rigid society, and, I'm just a person of my time, like everybody. And then in the 60s and 70s, that feeling that if you gave people freedom, lots of good would come from it. And some good did come from it, but of course now, sadly, we're wiser than knowing about that if you give people freedom, lots of bad comes from it as well. So it was a kind of optimistic time to some extent. And as I say, to my shame, I didn't really know about boundaries in the way that I know about them now. So that's partly. But how they feel, one of them, Colette, is an artist, and she does do some performances, mainly political kind of performances, about the environment and so on. And Lois, I think she might have struggled with it. I have got some bits of writing they did about what they think about it. I haven't asked them recently. I might ask them now when I get back, see what their latest update on their history is. But of course, as they get older, they probably know more about performances in general, whereas when they were young, they didn't have any friends that had anything to do with the world like that. So it was a bit, like we're in a world that nobody else is in. On the other hand, a lot of the places we went to, the other artists there were, really lovely to them. I can think of at least one residency we were in Poland, where they had their own room for their own artwork, their own gallery kind of thing. So they were appreciated a lot, and they probably enjoyed the appreciation, but then we were doing a lot of travelling and a bit of chaos, really, about where we're going to sleep tonight and that sort of thing.
It sounds like they had some amazing experiences, though.
Yes, of course, they don't remember most of them. Yes, I sometimes say to them, they talk about a certain country, and I say, oh, you've been there. It's like, oh, yeah, but we don't remember. Yeah. So, when they were teenagers, I can remember saying to a friend, oh, Lois and Colette aren't in our performances anymore. And then chirping up and saying, oh, well, that's because you haven't invited us recently. Oh, that's nice. You do want to be in something. Yeah. And then I think that was before we were doing something for Gateshead Garden Show. And so I thought, oh yeah, you can be in this. And they were.
Wonderful.
Shall I, have I got a moment for saying a last story? It's a very interesting one about when we were in Portugal.
I would love you to.
But it was, because these gallery organisers, they were from Porto, so they kind of descended on these small towns a bit to produce these art festivals. Obviously, when you're in another country, you don't know the whole story of what's behind it, but this particular one, we were there, the one where we were with Angela. So it was all going well. Orlon was there in the gallery, you know, kind of having people come up and kiss her for the whole day. And, you know, that kind of things were going on. And then come the Saturday, a whole lot of people came from, I think, the surrounding countryside, and there was a bit of a big demo. It wasn't long after the revolution in Portugal, and there was quite a lot of Stalinist graffiti around. So we were thinking they were these Stalinists. So they came, lots of angry people in the town, and our Portuguese hosts got in their cars and went. So we were left, all, you know, the foreign artists who hadn't come by car, we were left like, oh my goodness me. And I had these two, you know, blonde girls in the pushchair, and suddenly they looked very blonde because everybody's got dark hair, haven't they, in Portugal? And it's like, oh yes, I don't think they like foreigners, these people. So we had a Portuguese friend who took us to this cafe, and we were just kind of hiding in the cafe waiting for it to pass over. But gradually a little gang of men just went in a semicircle outside the cafe, just looking at us, just staring at us. And it's like, help, this doesn't look very good. I think we're going to have to move on. So we went through and went to another cafe. It's happened again, went to another one. Like, oh no, this is serious, we've got to do something. And what we did in the end, there was a hostel there, and so we all kind of barricaded, all foreign artists barricaded ourselves in this hostel. We had been staying with somebody, so the Portuguese artist went off to where we were staying, got our suitcases and so on. And then first thing in the morning, first train out, we all got on it and went. So there's the less good side of a lovely, you know, week in a small town in Portugal. Yeah, it did, really did turn quite sinister.
Wow. That's come to the end of our time, Shirley.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for speaking to us today. It's been really interesting to hear about your practice, how you've worked with children, and the spread of those years. So really appreciate it. Thank you very much.
That's fine. Yeah, it's been a pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you for listening. I'm Susan Merrick, and this was Woman Up, the podcast series by Desperate Artwives.